campus development and more and area, we're going to just talk about and more. We're going to do things a little bit differently. We really don't have different drawings. The drawings that are in the social hall are pretty much the most current ones that there are. And so I didn't want to, with minor changes, didn't want to run that by again. And I thought it would give us a chance to talk about some important concerns that that we need to face in this project. They're important concerns. They ought to be brought up, and they ought to be brought up forcefully, and they have. And pretty much they fall into three areas, that, at least the feedback that I've gotten. One is, are we a declining membership? Why are we enlarging this church and modernizing the church if we have a declining membership? Secondly, have we cuts due to shrinking pledges? Thirdly, can we really afford a mortgage, and do we have a plan? So we'll take them one at a time. The membership issues. I was kind of interested in this because when the membership committee put the numbers up, we had a 2011 census at 448, and it grew over the next couple of years. And we know that those numbers were inflated because the list hadn't really been cleaned up. And the Anteras and the sergeants in 2013, 14, 15 have cleaned the list up quite a bit. In fact, in that in the 2013-2014 time frame, there were nearly 100 people removed from the list, and there are a few more in 15, so we're probably over 100 people have gone off the list since 2011. The thing that I thought was interesting, we know that 448 was an inflated number, and yet today we're at 428. So the interesting thing to me, that kind of jumped out at me, is about one out of four congregants are new in the last 4 years. I don't know what that means programmatically or anything else, but I wouldn't guess that. I think it's kind of an interesting figure. So my take on it, you could argue that we've gained a few people. If the 2011 number was very, very inflated, you could argue that we've lost a few people. Essentially, at a time when other churches, for the most part, you read about it all the time, are shrinking, we have basically gone sideways over the last 4 years. The number of people who've left are about equal to the number of new people. And I'll Google it to Q&A at the end. Sorry, Barb, you did such a good job of laying this out. I missed that we're also going to talk about the construction schedule and a bridge loan concept, and then we'll go to Q&A. So we go to the next slide, which covers pledges. The concerns been raised that don't we have declining pledges, and hasn't that resulted in staff and program cuts? And it's a complicated question, it's a complicated answer, in that we have had program cuts, and monies have been shifted from some programs and some areas of the church, endeavors of the church, to other programs and other areas. But the opposite is actually true in terms of the pledges. We, in 2011, our actual pledge income was $403,000. 212, 461, 213, 500. The sub year, where we didn't even have, because it's kind of interesting, we did not even have we just asked people to continue. We didn't have a pledge drive for that extra 6 months, and the rate was actually greater than it had been in the previous year. So, I don't know what that is. I don't know what we should learn from that. 2014-15, the immediate past fiscal year, in 2015-2016, the one that we're in now, we had a structure in our financial department that just wasn't putting the information, it just wasn't getting us the data that we needed. And we have, you're probably aware, there have been some changes in the office. Jim Shevel and Joanne Copeland, and the rest of the office are working on untangling quite a bit of confusion. It was a confusing year to begin with, but we have some pledges for 2015-16 that were applied to the previous year, some for 2014-2015 that were mistakenly applied to the next year. And you throw the capital campaign into that, and some of those were mixed up. So we are going through a process. At this stage, we know we have pledges of somewhere between $475,000 and $500,000 for each of those years. But there are a bunch of individual accounts that need to be untangled, teased apart, and put in the right places. And it's simply going to take some time. And so I don't have an answer and can't give you a change for a few weeks until we get those completely untangled. Another interesting thing, I think, if you overlay this chart, this slide with the last one, our congregational count has gone sideways, but if you look in those 4 years, our actual pledges collected have gone up by 25%, and we raised nearly $1.5 million for a capital campaign. So, it's complicated. Where do you put your assets? Yes, there have been cuts. Some of the stuff went to other programs. But the pledge income in general has been, and we're still at question marks for 14-15 and 15-16, but pledges have been increasing to the tune of about 25% at the time, over a time frame that the congregation simply stayed the same income. And I think that's a pretty noteworthy thing. Okay, we can go to the next. Can we afford a mortgage, and do we have a plan? Two very important things. You'll flip through it. In May, we put up this slide showing the plan that we had, and I just verbalized to the numbers. We were looking at a $400,000 mortgage and hopefully a 30-year amortization. As it turns out, we only get 25, but and showed at various interest rates, 4%, 5%, 6%, what our monthly payment on that mortgage would be. And I had gotten with the office staff and talked about where could those funds come from as compared to the year, using the year that we were in as a base. And we targeted improved preschool performance, increased rental revenues, reduced energy costs, and reduced costs of repair and maintenance. So that was and I did attach some numbers verbally at that time, but we didn't put them up on the screen. So Barb, if you go to the next slide. We are going to have a 25-year amortization because they view us as a business, banks view us as a business. The improved preschool performance didn't come the way that we wanted it. We wanted it to get to a self-sustaining break-even situation, and it became clear that that just wasn't going to happen. And so we have an improved financial performance by virtue of having closed it. And that effect is a little over $1,500 a month. The second thing that we've already begun to realize is Jim Shettle has negotiated our energy suppliers, gas and electric suppliers down, and according to plan, so far, $300-some a month. And we expect with the building project and with further, getting some more energy efficiency in the construction project into this, that we'll build on that. So we're targeting about $2,500 or $2,600 in improved performance in order to afford the mortgage, and we've actually realized over $1,800 of that already. And we don't have to really use those savings until about a year from now. We'll still work on increased rental revenues and further reduce energy costs, and we should get with all new stuff, much new stuff, reduce costs of repair and maintenance. So the plan is, as you see it here, as compared to the base year of this past year, and we're 70% plus of the way there. So that's, I'll take questions at the end, but that's how we're planning to afford it. And the definitely some bumps in the road, but the I think it's important to understand the mortgage that we're taking on amounts to about 3 or 4%, 3 to 4% of our total annual budget. So I think that's a thing that we can, even if we hit some bumps on the road, we can manage around. Next, the schedule. Right now, the bid documents are being developed by Inform Studio, our architect, and they're working with McCarthy and Smith, our construction manager. In November, the construction manager will put these documents out for bid so that we can get hard numbers, actual bids, from contractors. In December, McCarthy and Smith will award those bids, and we'll be set with who's going to be actually doing the work. During the fourth quarter, and this will probably be a big topic in the next town hall meeting, we'll be looking at finishes and furnishing, you know, what color paint, what kind of flooring, and so on and so forth. So that'll be a little bit more fun than this one. In January and February, we'll be securing our financial commitments. We basically, at this point, have two banks, both of whom have said that they don't see any barriers to a $400,000 mortgage or to financing the $800,000 in bridge lending that we'll need to get through the time between when we do the construction and the end of the capital campaign coming in. It takes off. Well, we have 4 more years to go of funds coming in from the capital campaign, so that's what the $800,000 is for. A big thank you is due to this. There's more than one way to do value analysis. The architects and the engineers do some of it, but Wally and the Rummage crew sat down actually with the construction manager and worked it out so that we will not be missing a Rummage in the spring. They'll hold it about three weeks early, and the construction manager feels that we will be far enough along in October that they can, they'll just be finishing up, and they don't see a barrier to holding our October rummage as well. So that's a pretty big deal in terms of income, and everybody involved deserves a thank you, especially for the rummage committee. April 25th will be the day that the building begins to be demolished, and you have a chance to bid at the auction for the first sledgehammer.
That's
targeted for October completion. Again, we'll work through Rummage on that. There may be a couple of things to tie up in November, but we will plan on doing the parking lot exterior lighting in November and be done with the project. So only is that 13 months from today to completion. We wanted to introduce a financing concept, and this is not a solicitation. We're not asking for money, but we held a couple of focus groups to talk about whether congregants might be interested in, at a certain interest rate, lending money to the church for either the mortgage or the bridge loan or both. And the general consensus that came out of those meetings, we had about 16 or 18 congregants participate, was that probably folks would not be interested in tying up their money for 25 or 30 years for the long-term financing, but that there may be interest in funding the $800,000 over a 4-year period with the objective that the church saves some money over what they would be paying in interest rate to the bank, and that the congregants might be able to do better than they can do in CDs or bonds or whatever. Have it be a win-win. So the concept is, and again, it's not a solicitation. We're going to ask for filling out cards at the end of this, or contacting Joanne Copeland via email to express your interest if you have any. The concept would be to form an LLC with 800 shares, say at $1,000 a share for the $800,000, offer it to BUC congregants. The lending period would be July of this coming year through the end of the capital campaign, which should end in December of 2019. There may be a couple of 3 months slop over as we collect the final bills, but the payback would be monthly. We would offer it at 3% interest, and by doing so, we would save somewhere, if the bank offers it at 4 and we congregants take it on at 3, the savings and interest to the church would be $12,000. So that's the sort of the driver of it. And we don't have to have it because, we've got the banks pretty well committed to financing it if congregants don't want to go that way. So if you're interested, Barb will hand out 3x5 cards as you exit today. And if you just want to write down, there's no commitment whatsoever. It's just an expression of interest in being a part of that funding of the $800,000. Fill out a card, there's a box on the piano. Or if you want to think about it, which is more likely scenario anyway, if you could get that email amount to Joanne Copeland by the end of October, or by October 30th, and her email address is there. So that's the and more without the campus development. And at this point, I'll open it up to questions and answers. Larry.
This savings.
Please use the microphone.
Savings of $12,000 would be contingent on selling 800 shares, wouldn't it?
Yes.
So that's a lot.
Yes. I guess two yeses. And to be clear, let's follow that up. We wouldn't want to do both because there are bank fees involved and there's cost in setting up an LLC. And so if there's enough congregant interest in lending $800,000, great. If it's $200,000 or $300,000 and we have to manage two paybacks,
Dick, my question relates to that. Would you be able to use money from an IRA account or a retirement account?
Well, it would have to be cash paid into the corporation. So that's a question for
the
lender. Yes, it would be a question for the advisor.
Yes, you could.
Dick, would interest be paid quarterly? 6 months?
Well, that remains to be seen. I mean, we'll get to the expression of interest first. Every day, Jim.
No. Give it a check.
Daily. We would work out a simple program, whatever that is. That's been made clear to me.
I'm wondering about the administration of that. Is that something that our own staff would have to administer, or someone else?
If we can do it simply and automate, I mean, we might insist on it's got to go out on an automatic basis, and we're not writing checks and putting them in the mail. It's got to go out on an automatic basis to the bank accounts of the folks that own it. So we can't burden the staff. Has got a lot to do right now. So we could look for an outside party and pay them some modest amount. We're going to be using an outside consultant on some of our financial structure and reporting and so on and so forth. Maybe that person can do it. But again, if we get the expression of interest, we'll figure out the simplest and least expensive way to administer it and least burdensome to the staff.
In terms of revenue loss or whatever, making the monthly payments on the mortgage, I'd like to remind everyone that shopping with Scrip at BUC is an easy way for all of us to contribute on a regular basis. Our three-person household contributed over $500 last year through Scrip, and that's simply with groceries that we buy all the time, regular purchases for gasoline, clothing. So these are not extravagant or extra expenses that are bringing in money to BUC. It's everyday spending that all of us do. An organization our size is estimated to be able to easily bring in $20,000 to $30,000 a year through SCRIP. Currently, we bring in less than $8,000. So I would encourage everyone to reinvestigate SCRIP. It takes a little work to get it set up, but once it's set up, it's an easy way for you to give money back to BUC with things that you buy every day.
I just have a couple comments. One is, I appreciate the clear thinking that I see demonstrated. Gives me more confidence.
Doesn't always feel like it.
It was very interesting that we have so many, such a high percentage of new members. I would like, in this room, people who have not been here longer than 5 years to stand up. And I think they should get an applause because that's what we need. Your friends.
Well, I guess we have to have pictures to have more questions, huh?
or more confusion, so clearly.
Just one quick question. How are the construction companies being selected for quoting?
We've hired a construction manager. They are being sensitive to the environmental aspects of the contractors and the, if you will, the ethics of the contractors. They may not all be union contractors, but they're solid people who pay their people well, and there's a requirement of how they're being disposed, the disposal of the what's left over after you knock it down and so on. And I'm gonna hard time getting that out. But anyway. But it is being left, the church is not choosing the people, the construction manager has been hired to do that.
Dick, if I could just say that in different words. We've hired a construction manager for a set fee to perform a management and administration function. All of the individual subcontracts for carpentry, concrete work, steel work, and so forth, interior finishes, all those different trades will be let out as individual competitively bid subcontracts. So the construction manager makes a set fee that we agreed on, looking at what they and we thought that was worth. On a competitive basis, we interviewed and selected a construction manager from in a competitive setting and evaluated and so forth and selected him. And then he does all the rest of the work for us, but it's all, every trade is competitively bid. So that's the selection process.
John, you might mention that he also did the, sanctuary.
Yeah, it turns out the firm that was selected did this sanctuary classroom edition in 95 and 96, and we were prejudiced. We looked at everybody very carefully. We like him. Yeah.
Me too. Dick, I don't remember the numbers from the very first town halls on this, but was the plan from the beginning to borrow $400,000 and then the $800,000 bridge loan? Has that held steady or has that changed?
It depends on what you define the beginning, but for many, many months, that is, you know, at least a year, I think.
Okay.
Those have been them. And we budgeted the interest, point I didn't make clear, the interest being paid on the bridge loan is not coming out of the operational budget of the church. $50,000 of the capital campaign receipts are set aside to pay the interest on the bridge loan.
I have two questions, and I apologize.
apologize, I was late if you went over these earlier. What's the name of the construction manager? And also, how much disruption will there be during the construction phase?
McCarthy and Smith is the name of the construction manager, and there will be plenty of disruption. I mean, basically, Jim Shell and the staff are, there won't be disruption getting into the sanctuary, but we will lose some rental income because the classrooms are being, the corridor rooms are being remodeled, the front entryway and lobby and that sort of thing will be completely demolished. So there is going to be significant disruption from the third week of April till probably early October.
Where will the office be?
The office doesn't move. Yeah, the office is not changing. I have a comment and a question, but I hadn't thought about mentioning this before, and I should have included it, that as you know, the preschool is closing, which opens up two additional rooms on the lower level with a total of over 1,100 square feet. And so that will, it'll be worked out with the prioritization folks on our committee as well as music and RE, but there may be some shifting in RE and music and where, what rooms they use and where and so on. And rent.
If the pledges are up for the last year or two, why is there a reduction in staff then?
That's an item that I'd rather have somebody else tackle because I'd rather Kathy relate to that. But monies have not been taken out of the church in total. They have been shifted. You heard Rudolph today. We've spent more on the music program. There was money that was being, frankly, utilized to subsidize the preschool in the hope that it would get into a profitable and become a revenue generator rather than, so that decision was made by the executive and by the board, and that one didn't work out. And so there, I'd rather Kathy answer that because there are a lot of nuances where she as the executive and with the board, she is the executive primarily, moved funds into different areas. And some of that involved some staff. We should get a fuller answer. We should prepare a fuller answer. That's an important question. But the total revenues of the church in each of those years went up, not down. Okay. If those who are interested want to grab a card and put a number down and put it in the box on the piano, great. Otherwise, if you have any interest, get in touch with Joanne Copeland, who's also handling the pledges and that sort of thing, so there'll be confidentiality. Would be appreciated. And I'm always available, as are the rest of the CDPC, to answer questions. Thank you.